This is a journey. This is a journey. This is a journey into sound. This is a journey into sound. Along the way, we'll bring to you new color, new dimension, new depth. Journey into sound. A journey which along the way will bring to you new color, new dimension, new value.
Pump up the volume. Pump up the volume.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this live science series. My name is Faith Dukes, Dr. Faith Dukes. I'm director of K-12 programs here at Berkeley Lab, and I want to thank you for joining us today. A year ago, when we began this live science series as an opportunity to connect with the public and showcase the innovation and research here at Berkeley Lab, we wanted to share the very human aspect of our researchers. In the next year, we look forward to continuing to share their stories and to connect to the embedded aspects of STEM in culture, community, and art. We're happy to have you join us for this first in a series that on this first federal celebration of Juneteenth showcases the innovation of engineers within the hip hop community. Just a reminder, our title is a quick, it shows what we'll be doing today, just scratching the surface. So over the next hour, we hope that you get an introduction into hip hop and STEM and the importance of the vinyl record to hip hop as an instrument. So now I'd like to introduce my co-host for today, Alisa Battelli, who's an astrophysicist, educator, and our instruction and content coordinator here with our K-12 team. So Alisa, welcome to the Zoom stage.
Thanks so much, Faith. And I am just really excited to be joining you today for our hip hop STEM journey. But so as Faith mentioned, we work at Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory, or Berkeley Lab for short. And just in case you haven't joined us for a previous live science session, Berkeley Lab is one of the 17 Department of Energy National Labs. And we're located in, as you might guess, Berkeley, California. And Berkeley Lab is home to 14 Nobel Prizes and credited with the discovery of 16 elements on the periodic table. And we also like to say we have the best view from a lab, as you can see from our picture here. But all right, I'm gonna pass it back to you, Faith, for some quick reminders and introduction.
So quick reminders, if you haven't already, Alisa is going to add in the chat box a link to our programs here at Berkeley Lab for virtual life science. So we have put together an activity guide that goes along with this session that can give you a behind the scenes look at our panelists, their biographies, as well as some links that we think you should check out to go a little bit deeper beyond the surface level information that we might give you today. You'll see a button at the bottom of your screen for closed captioning, and we're actually going to turn on our closed transcription or our transcription now so that you can actually read that if you'd like to. So you'll see that button at the bottom of your screen. It allows you to use closed captioning for this session. Second, again, if you haven't already downloaded it, the link is in the chat box. We have the accompanying sheet, and we encourage you to use that chat box often. Ask any questions that you have of our panelists here today and of us as co-hosts. We will be checking for your questions and comments throughout the session and also asking you a few questions as well. We hope you can stay with us for the whole session, but in case you do have to go, we are recording this session. You'll be able to find the recording on our website next week, along with previous live science sessions that cover numerous topics, including soil science, star formation, and particle physics. So, think we have a question. Yep.
Yeah, let's do it. So Faith mentioned let's use the chat box. So we want to get to know all of you. So we're going to start with our first question, which is what city, town are you watching from? So let us know in the chat box, where are you watching from? We have Concord, we have Oakland, Seattle, San Francisco, San Diego, Chicago, Mountain View, Los Angeles, San Francisco, Fairfield. What? That's awesome. Madison, Wisconsin. Awesome. Glad you're joining us. Oh, that was great. Thank you everyone for all the engagement. And we can move on to another question we'd like to ask. So, as our live science centered around music, name the last artist or song you listened to. We'd love to know. From the Jewels, Grimes, BTS. Yes. Ooh, someone listened to Jahi. I love that. Coldplay, Maria, Trey Songz, Justin Bieber, still alive, still going. All right, I love it. I love all the music that we're watching. Thank you everyone for sharing in the chat box. And we encourage you throughout the session, as Faith said, to keep asking us questions, keep giving us the comments. We love this engagement. So now we would love to introduce two more people into the session. We just kind of saw them earlier at the turntables. And first, our first presenter is Jahi. He is an MC, DJ, songwriter, and entrepreneur who lives in nearby Oakland. His career spans 22 years and 17 albums, and he has traveled to 20 museums around the world presenting hip hop as a world culture. Our next panelist is our own Miles Green. Miles joined Berkeley Lab as the audio-visual technical specialist in 2019. During the day, he provides audio, sound, lighting, and video conferencing expertise to the lab community. And at night, he's a versatile and dynamic DJ who's honed his craft of making people move across the world with eclectic blend of hip hop, R&B, soul, Latin, and world music. So without further ado, I'd like to have our co-presenters, Jahi and Miles, come to the Zoom stage, so they're already here, and give us a little bit of what they're going to do today. So, hey, Miles, hi, Jahi. Thanks for joining us. All right, we're going to turn it over to you, Jahi.
You're vibing with DJ Miles Green.
To all the low riders, big riders, DJ Miles Green.
You to say, hey, I like the way the DJ is playing, cause that's what you'll be saying. For you to say, hey, I like the way the DJ is playing, cause that's what you'll be saying. For you to say, hey, I like the way the DJ is playing, hey, I like the way the DJ is playing, hey, I like the way the DJ is playing, hey, I like the way the DJ is playing, cause that's what you'll be saying. For you to say, hey, I like the way the DJ is playing, cause that's what you'll be saying.
DJ Miles Green, DJ Miles Green.
Jahi.
That was amazing. Wow. And thanks everyone for the comments and chat box. Keep it coming. We get to see it. And so now we'll actually have a little Q&A with our DJs right here, just to sort of get to know them, get to know what they were doing. So we're going to start off with Jahi. How did you become inspired to become a DJ?
Lisa, thank you for that question, and thank you for having me, Berkeley Lab. My origins as a DJ really begins with my mother. My mother was the first DJ that I knew. She had the first record collection that I had ever seen, and I could tell something about her mood. So I realized that music could actually affect your spirit and your energy. If she was playing Aretha Franklin, that meant pancakes on Sunday. If she was playing Al Green, that means she was probably having a date. So I was going over friend's house. But I was inspired to be a DJ by my mother really instilling in me that records were far more important than television. And I'm the age of hip hop. So I turned 50 in 90 days, and hip hop is turning 50 in 2023. So I actually grew up at the birth of this culture. So I saw DJs in 1979 and 1980 playing a lot of the records that I'm going to play today. So that's a little bit about what's inspired me.
And Miles, I want to ask you a similar question. You were born and raised here in Oakland. And so what inspires you to become a DJ?
You know, I was blessed to have parents who knew about music and exposed me to a lot of it. I got a pair of drums at 2 years old. One of my earliest memories of life was just playing that drum in the garage until it just wore out. You know, I learned to play clarinet. And in elementary school, learned to read music and played in the school band all through elementary school, and picked up DJing in junior high around the age of 13. So I'm from the West Coast, right? We looked at Crush Groove and Beat Street and Break-In and all the great stuff that was coming out in the early 80s in New York. Like, wow, that's what we wanted to be. So I got a pair of turntables, and I was just a studious kind of nerdy kid. I used to sit there with my records and listen to the beats. And one of my favorite records that really inspired me was the album cover. It was called Mantronics, Needle to the Groove. And that was the last little record that I was just playing. It just showed the graffiti, the breakdancing, the music, the culture, the art, all mixed into one. And ever since I can remember, that's what I wanted to be and do. So I'm blessed that I was able to, through 10,000 hours of hard work, become that.
Awesome, Miles. So I'm going to start back with you on the next question. You just talked about how hip hop has its own style, and from beatboxing to the way you wear your, you know, clothing, to the way you are a rapper, to the way you do lyrics. How would you say your style is as a DJ? Could you comment on that and talk about the style that you've put into how you make a body of people move with your music?
Right on. My theory is that the beats and the music and the tempo affect people's emotions, right? So you got to layer the beats in a way that people feel. And if we go through like what I just played, it was break beats. That's my style, right? I consider myself a hip hop DJ who knows how to play all types of music, but I mix it and scratch it and layer it like it's hip hop because it's fun. So I play a little, you know, 1-2-1-2 hip hop beat. I mix it with a little bass only. I'm not going to say the songs I played, but you heard one had a clap, one had bass only. Then I went over into phrases. Hey, I know you like the way the DJ is playing, right? And then I finished up with another little drum beat. So I'm just a drummer at heart, you know, and that's what I listen for, the drums and the kicks. And I try to incorporate all different styles of music, but just focus on the mathematical formulas of BPM and make sure my mixes are tight.
I love that, Miles. I love you bringing in the drums, the BPM, the math, right? This is all a STEM story. And a similar question to Jahi about your style. How can you describe your style?
Well, I want to describe my style as I play the turntables like an instrument. So similar to how a trumpet player, or you would have a trio and everybody has time and space and opportunity to improvise. That's how I go about my DJing and my style. I'm not a club DJ. I really am not the person who wanna play in clubs. I love doing things like this. And I just finished traveling to 20 museums around the world presenting hip hop as a world culture. And we included the turntable. So my style is really, some people call it old school, but I love that because I actually, in 1981, there were block parties in my neighborhood all the time. So I saw DJs all the time and I watched the science of how they could use sound, time, and space and understand the environment and create these musical palettes of music. And you got to understand that in the 70s, in the early 80s, there were no hip hop records. So the DJ for me helped to develop my style to really know to study music. So I collect records from 1972 to 1979 because the best of the 70s music is what we see in the birth of hip hop. And as Miles was talking, you know, when I did that, my first opening, I was cutting that Jam Master Jay because Jam Master Jay is the first DJ I ever saw that did it worldwide and really let us know that the things you were alluding to, Faith, the way we dress, the style, the elements, that's our culture, the culture of hip hop. So my role is to be able to add something. And I really like to select records. That's why I'm glad Miles is here. He got those styles. I'm more of a, just notice the records I select. And if you don't know what they are, they may drive you to a point of discovery.
It's really cool. We're looking forward to hearing all the different records you have. And we're gonna jump in with a question from the audience. So we have Angel wants to know, how does one become a DJ?
So if I could answer that, I would say the number one thing is work on your rhythm and timing and your knowledge of music. I think now with the new technologies, people tend to think that if I put a bunch of music on a computer and I have a fancy setup, I could just push some buttons and play music for people. That's not what DJing is about, right? You'd be better off just tapping your finger or taking a drumstick and tapping it on the floor and making sure that you literally become a human metronome, because that's what a DJ is about, counting the time and making sure that every song that you play, all the instruments match, that the tempo matches, and that is what affects the emotions of people.
And to add, I would just say, if you're interested in becoming a DJ, remember that DJing is a part of hip hop culture. So you want to expose yourself to all of the culture. And one of the best ways that you can become a DJ is by listening. The ability to be able to listen through records and listen to records that are in multi genres, not just hip hop genre. As much as you're able to be able to listen, I would say get you some turntables. I am of the mindset that I believe that Serato is great, but I think it's also equally important to make sure that you also, if you're going to be a DJ, spend some time on vinyl. I think that will make a difference in your world. But remember that DJing is a part of a larger culture that may take you a lot of great places.
Thanks so much for answering, Miles and Jahi. And again, thanks, Angel, for the question. Again, audience, keep the questions coming and the comments in the chat box. But yeah, so Jahi, can you tell us a little bit about the music you were playing earlier?
As I started out with a Detroit producer by the name of Tall Black Guy. And then I use the Paid in Full. And again, I'm using all vinyl today. And what you saw me do at the very beginning basically is blending those two records together. So being able to understand the beats per minute for one record and another record and being able to have them play simultaneously and then have the creative fun to be able to manipulate those. So those were the first two when the video was happening. And then again, I used Run DMC. That was Jam Master Jay. And then the music that was playing was the Fugees. It was actually a reggae mix of the song Fuji Lies. So again, everything today that I'll be doing is all vinyl.
Nice. And I'll just jump right in. So Pump Up the Volume, Eric B and Rakim. This is a journey into sound, right? Classic drum beat. And you can see part of my style is scratching over phrases. And making the music kind of come alive. So what I'll do is I'll take little bits and pieces of music, set cue points, and then I'll jump back and forth to those in order to tell you a story. I'm one that started on vinyl. I learned with vinyl. There was no computer DJing when I started, right? And I was actually very hesitant to move over to the digital. But once I realized the power of it, this is about expressing things to people. So if you can take bits and pieces of sounds and put it into people's mind, heart, and soul, that's what it's all about. I started out with Q-Tip, Let's Ride, which is one of my favorite producers. Q-Tip is great for taking an old funk, soul, R&B record and turning it into a hip-hop record, which we'll talk about a little bit more. After that, I played Madlib. Grooving. That's just one of my favorite little things from my Groove Lounge show, which some of you are familiar with. And then I played Biggie, Hypnotized, but just the beat. Shout out to my wife on that one. That's one of her favorite records. Then I went into Special Ed, Action. So let me just say real quick, back in the day, the MCs would make entire songs about their DJ. I see somebody put a thing in the chat about the state of hip hop. It morphed to where the MC is the primary. But when it started, it was about the DJ. So Special Ed had a DJ called Action Love. He made a song called Action. And that was the little, hey, I know you like the way the DJ is playing. After that, I played some DJ Premier Production, which is one of my favorite DJs of all time. Another one that just took our culture and put it on wax in a way that we've all followed. So shout out to DJ Premier. And with that, I'll send it back to you, Faith.
So what you've heard is a lot of breaks. You've heard a lot of music. We've also given you some history to start. But what if we wanted to go back like and get some like old sounds? And I mean like really, really old sounds. Hey, Miles, I think we need a sound expert.
Yeah, you know, I know someone who actually could help us with that. Give us a little education.
Word up.
I'd like to introduce Dr. Carl Haber. Carl is a MacArthur Fellow physicist developing new technologies for the preservation of sound recordings. Thanks so much for joining us, Carl. Over to you.
Thank you, it's a pleasure.
So I think, Carl, before we get into what you're doing here at the lab, we wanna ask first a question to our audience, because we gotta back it up before we can get into using the technologies to restore sound, we gotta ask the question, what is sound? So we want you all to answer in the chat box for us.
We have some answers coming in. I love it, we see vibrations and frequencies, waves, a wave, a vibration of air in a form, a lot of vibrations and waves, ooh, energy propagations that vibrates air. I love these answers. And so Carl, how did we do?
I think we did really well, actually. I think putting it all together, I think the participants pretty much got it all right. But let's break it down a little more and kind of get back to the fundamentals. So sound is a particular type of air pressure. So what does that actually mean? So pressure is a force exerted on matter over an area. And we're all familiar with this concept, like in our everyday lives. For example, if a balloon is not being inflated or deflated, then the air pressure is constant and equal to the air pressure outside due to the atmosphere. On the other hand, the wind, which we're also, of course, very familiar with, is due to differences in pressure, like from one place to another. So when the wind gusts, that pressure is actually changing. So what about sound? Well, sound is also a type of pressure, which is changing, but it's changing like in a very periodic or repetitive way. It's due or it's caused by the vibration of a material. And this pressure wave, a lot of the people talked about waves in the chat box, that wave can travel from one place to another. So here in the picture on my right, well, that's my son when he was little. He's strumming on his ukulele. And when he does this, he establishes a sound wave, which is traveling from his instrument to your ears. And the picture off to the side, well, that's a kind of a cartoon, but it represents this, like the changes in density or pressure of the air as the sound wave travels along.
That's awesome, Carl. I have a quick question. Can we hear sound everywhere?
Huh. Well, that is a really good question. And I think a good way to look at that is to remember that sound can only exist in matter, in a gas, in a liquid, in a solid. So it's pretty popular in the movies, like to show battles between spaceships with big explosions, such as in this well-known film. So the question is, what's wrong with this? Well, what's wrong with this is that you would never hear an explosion in space. You'd see it, but you would never hear it because space is a vacuum. So if you hear sound in a space battle, that's because it's happening in Hollywood. Okay, so another question is, like, what are the properties of sound? So sound has a couple of important properties that are really important to keep track of. One of those properties we call the pitch or the tone, and that's due to the period or the spacing between the pressure maximum and the pressure minimum. And when we think about pitch and tone, like a high pitch might be a whistle, so that's a high frequency, and a low pitch might be a tuba or a bass, which is a low frequency. So high frequency, high pitch, like a whistle, low frequency, like a tuba. The other property of sound is that it has a volume or amplitude, and that's just basically how loud it is. So that's how much higher the highest pressure is from the lowest pressure. And the other important property of sound is that sound can be transferred. It can be transferred from one material to another, like from the speaker or the strings of the musical instrument to the air, and from the air to your eardrum. The other thing is that complex sounds, like chords or the sound of a band or the sound of an orchestra, can really be thought of mathematically as just an addition or a sum of pretty simple basic tones. Like the A major chord, well, that's just three simple tones that are added up together.
All right, so that's awesome. Now we know what sound is. But how does sound get recorded? How can we record sound? So what do you all in the audience think? how can we record sound? Let us know in the chat box. See some answers coming in, the electronics. Any other guesses? Samples, all right, see some samples. Sensors, physical methods, microphones, an iPhone, transferring sound, vibrations in a crystal from Dr. Stone. It's pretty cool. But anyways, Carl, back to you. How do you think we did?
Okay, well, I think there were some interesting answers there and a lot of things that I expected people to say because, you know, everybody carries around their iPhone or their smartphone and pretty much everybody takes it for granted that we can just, you know, record sound by pressing a button. But let's take it back again to where it all started. So in the middle of the 1800s, like 150 years ago, people became aware of a new invention, which was called photography. And now in photography, it had nothing to do with sound. What photographers did is that they were able for the first time to capture light on paper. And when they did that, a couple of other people looked at that and said, well, these guys can capture light on paper, why can't we capture sound on some material? And if you did that, what would that be called? How about phonography? So what's shown here is one of the very earliest photographs that was ever taken. It's a picture of Paris, France, and there's a picture of a human standing there. It's a first picture that actually shows a human being. So one of the people that took this really to heart was a Frenchman. Well, photography was invented in France, and it was another Frenchman by the name of Edouard Leon Scott de Martinville. And he was an inventor, and he created a machine inspired by photography. He created a machine which he called the phone autograph, literally the sound self-writer. And he was the first person to capture sound on a material. And in his case, it was actually paper. So how did it work? Well, it's actually a picture of his machine, which is shown on the middle left. There was a horn, I think you can see the horn, into which a person could speak. And the horn would focus the sound down to the base of the horn. And there at the base was a stretched membrane like a drum head. It appears here in the picture as yellow. And attached to that drum head or that membrane was the stiff hair pulled from the side of a pig. Now Scott took a strip of paper and he blackened it with the smoke from a kerosene lamp and he wrapped it around a rotating cylinder. You can see that black cylinder. You can see the long, thin line, which is the pig's hair, which is in contact with both the membrane and the blackened paper. Now, as the person spoke and the cylinder rotated, the pattern of the vibrations that were transferred from the air to the membrane to the pig's hair was written on the paper and is shown near the bottom of the screen. So Scott could actually record sound for the very first time in history with this device, but he couldn't play it back. In fact, his idea at the time was that folks would learn to visually read the patterns and be able to recognize the words. So it was a way of capturing sound, but in a way that it would just be read by somebody. So about 17 years or so later, along comes a man whose name probably everybody knows, which is Thomas Alva Edison. So Edison, had some of the same ideas, and he was thinking along some of the same lines as Edward Leon Scott de Martinville, but he actually didn't know about Scott's work. So instead of writing sound on paper, he had the idea to create a texture. So he embossed the sound on tin foils. Now, because the sound was now a texture instead of just a line, he could also reverse his process. He had a machine that was very similar to Scott's machine. There was a bristle, there was a membrane, there was a horn. But now by turning it backwards, he could push the horn with the foil that had the sound recorded on it, and he could create the sound as a reproduction. So that was a really big breakthrough because now people could actually hear with their ears something that had been recorded at an earlier time. Now, we believe that the very first recordings that Edison made are lost, but we do have one recording from about 6 months after his first demonstration of his phonograph, which was June of 1878. And it's a recording of trumpets playing music. It's the oldest recording we know of, which was made in this way. So I think we can have a listen, but please remember that this is a very crude process at the time. So don't expect it to sound really clear, like what you're used to or what Miles and Jahi played for you. It's not gonna be that way. But listen carefully, you're gonna hear one of the oldest sounds in the world. I hope you could hear that. It's also, you know, quite easy to find this in some of the resource materials, and you can also find it online if you want to listen to it again at your leisure.
So actually, Carl, I want to break in for a second and bring someone else to our attention that might not be as well known as the inventors you've mentioned. He's an important inventor and patent draftsman that's part of this story. Lewis Howard Latimer had a deep knowledge of patents and electrical engineering, which made him an indispensable partner to Thomas Alva Edison, and he promoted and defended Edison's light bulb design. So Latimer was directly involved with the telephone, and he worked with Alexander Graham Bell. He drafted the patent for Bell's design of the telephone, and he also was involved in the field of incandescent lighting, which was a particularly competitive field. And so as we've had discussions about developing this session, we've noted that history shows us innovation doesn't happen alone. We can see that Lewis Latimer has a direct connection from Edison to Alexander Graham Bell, who I think you're talking about next, right?
So Faith, thank you for bringing this in and for telling us about Lewis Latimer. He's a really important figure and a really interesting story about the incredible things that he did. And in fact, you're right. He was one of the only people that actually worked with both Thomas Edison and Alexander Graham Bell, who were competitors. And in fact, right after Edison's invention, Alexander Graham Bell had recently invented the telephone, which Latimer drew the drawings of. And then Bell immediately got interested in sound recording. So Bell actually makes a really important innovation. So for Edison and Scott, they recorded sound on the surface of a cylinder. In Edison's case, it was a tinfoil cylinder. In Leon Scott the Martinville's case, it was a paper-covered cylinder. But in both cases, the path that they recorded the sound on, it follows a shape called the helix, which you can see at the lower left where it says helix, kind of the shape of a spring. And the position along the helix corresponds to time along the sound. But a few years later, 1881, Alexander Graham Bell, he actually created the first disc record. Now, I think the disc record is pretty familiar to folks because obviously we've grown up with it, and the DJs were spinning discs a few minutes ago. So on a disc record, instead of the sound following this helix, instead follows the path of a spiral, starting at the inside, at the outside, and spiraling in at a constant rate to the inside. And the sound is a wiggling pattern along that spiral. So when you have one of these records, the record will rotate at a particular rate, which we typically call the RPM, or the revolutions per minute. So for example, if a record was to rotate at 60 RPM, that would mean that the record makes one complete turn in 1 second, or 60 per minute. So if you were to record a simple tone like the note A, which is 440 vibrations per second, you'd see 440 of these wiggles of the groove in one trip around the disc. So let's have a listen to Bell's very first disc, which is the great, great, great grandparent of all the discs which are spun by hip hop DJs and, well, everyone who plays disc records. And again, like the Edison recording, this is a really old recording. It's very noisy, but if you listen carefully, you can hear mouth sounds, which are called trills. It's the sound that happens when you kind of blow air through your lips. And And you'll also hear someone counting six numbers from 1 to 6. Okay, I hope you could hear that. And this record, you can also find it if you poke around online. It's part of the Smithsonian's collection, and they have a nice video actually about it. You can easily find online. So since Edison, Scott, and Latimer, it's been about 150 years, and sound has now been recorded on dozens of materials in many shapes and sizes. And some of these are so old and so delicate, like the ones we just looked at, and so damaged that we can no longer play them safely. So the question is, what do we do about that? So this takes us back to the original question that Miles and Jahi asked. If you have some really old records that you want to use, what do you do? Well, turns out we might be able to help you here at Berkeley Lab. All the stuff I just explained about sound and recordings, I actually learned most of that stuff about 20 years ago because I became interested in using some of the 21st century technology available at Berkeley Lab to help museums and libraries and DJs recover the oldest known recordings in history. So we use an idea which we developed here. So what we did is we use special microscopes that we can use to scan the records and essentially take pictures of them, turn them into digital images on a computer, and then use the computer to analyze the images. And using a model of sound and the sound recording process, we can extract the sound. So it's actually an amazing trip back, because remember, sound recording started with people being interested in photography. And by the way, those very early recordings of Bell and Edison that we just listened to, they were actually considered lost until the lab stepped in about 10 years ago and restored them both with this technology, which we call Irene. So Miles and Jahi, let me know if you want to use any of these old recordings, and I will do my best to set you up.
All right. Well, Miles and Jahi, I hope you're thinking about some samples for Carl. It's really cool that technology was developed here at Berkeley Lab, Carl. Thanks so much. We learned so much about sound and sound recording. Now it's time for a stretch break. So our DJs are back, and they'll be playing some songs.
Let me break it down for you again. Let me break it down for you again.
hands, everybody, body, if you got what it takes, cause I'm Curtis Blow, and I want you to know that these are the breaks. Everybody, if you got what it takes, cause I'm Curtis Blow, and I want you to know that these are the boys. These are the boys. Hands, everybody, if you got what it takes, cause I'm Curtis Blow, and I want you to know that these are the breaks. These are the breaks. Everybody, if you got what it takes, cause I'm Curtis Blow, and I want you to know that these are the boys. Clap your hands, everybody, if you got what it takes, cause I'm Curtis Blow, and I want you to know that these are the
Miles on the breaks, man, super, super
These
dope.
Are the breaks.
I hope you all are enjoying what you are seeing and experiencing right now. I also want to say shout out to Berkeley Lab, 90th anniversary, first time this is happening. What we want to do is we want to talk a little bit about what just happened. So I started, and just to give you, a lot of times when you go to the club and you see the DJ making you dance, you never know what exactly is happening. We wanted to break down the science because one of the terms that we say is that when we are creating, we're in the lab, similar to scientists. So in a lot of ways, what we're doing is science. And what I took was two vinyl records. I took the acapella of Doo-Wop That Thing by Miss Lauryn Hill. And then I also took the instrumental by Beyonce, Deja Vu featuring Jay-Z. And what I did was, is I manipulated the, as Carl was talking earlier about pitch and tone, I manipulated the pitch to make Miss Lauryn Hill move faster to stay connected with the Beyonce record. And then that Let Me Break It Down For You Again is basically just my my ability of the way I scratch. And the way I scratch is the same way as a horn player would blend in with a bass player or with a drummer. So just certain inflections, using our hand back and forth. Hey, Miles, tell them a little bit about what was the first thing that you played. We'll go back and forth, and then we'll share everything we played. So those were the first two that I used. I have two more.
Right on, right on. Appreciate you, sir. Curtis Blow, These Are the Breaks. Now, that's a whole song of its own. But as I said earlier, my thing is taking pieces of music and doing them in rapid succession in order to create a feeling. That's what DJing is about. So These Are the Breaks, Lil Apache, the Sugar Hill Gang, a different version by the incredible Bongo Band. And then I just went into some funk. As Jahi mentioned earlier, when we started, it was all funk, right? We took funk soul records and we used the breaks in order to create a art form or genre called hip hop. So things like Lakeside, Fantastic Voyage, and Cheryl Lynn, Got to Be Real, is classic funk that you could see how I just cut it and mixed it in a hip hop style. Go ahead, Jahi.
Oh, super, super dope, man. And then what I did was I was like, well, let me get brand new on you. Shout out to Black Panther, Wakanda Forever, since we live from Oakland. And what I did was is Pray For Me by Weeknd and Kendrick Lamar. What I was doing is juggling back and forth, which we'll talk about who are the inventors of juggling. And juggling is the ability to keep two vinyl records happening at the same time that doesn't stop. And the reason why we always look for the break is, if you've ever heard the term B-boys and B-girls, the B stands for the break. So what we were looking for and holding through juggling is holding the beat, the break beat. So the beginning of Pray For Me is a break beat. And the reason why it's a break beat is because there's no voices there. If you notice that as we were moving back and forth, you didn't hear the actual song, because that's the break part. So I did Pray For Me, and then I ended with SZA, All The Stars In Motion, because although I'm an old school DJ using vinyl, I figured I'd pull out something new. So Miles, what else did you use? Was there one other thing you used?
So yes, sir. If I could just add to what he was saying, if we want to define what the break is, right? It was an old record that, so now songs are verse, chorus like that, right? But in jazz arrangements, you just have each artist is able to freestyle for a time during, and it could be an 8-minute song, right? And that's how the old disco and funk records were. Like if you take James Brown, for example, they would do their verse, they would do their chorus, and then at some point he would go Clyde, and then Clyde Stubblefield, the drummer, would just boom, 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 and just play that sweetest part of the record. And so what we do as DJs, we take that little sweet break part of the record and we make it repeat over and over and over in order to create a groove. So what I did was I was playing with the clap. You know, and I played Me, Myself, and I. That was De La Soul. It starts with boop, 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 right? And then also Knee Deep by Parliament starts that way. So I mixed into that. And then the last one I played was called Brick, Ain't Gonna Hurt Nobody. And what I was doing is just taking that 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4 drummer intro and showing how that is actually the intro to a lot of different songs. I could go on and on. Back to you.
So we're going to talk about who are the creators of that. But now what we want to really get into our setups and how we're actually doing this. And the reason why we're going to show some of these things is that we also going to show who the inventors are. So if you know that I'm a part of the member of the Public Enemy family, so I have a slip mat, and this is from Public Enemy, but I also have some wax paper that's up under it because it helps the record to slide. And I will say in 1982, I saw a DJ do that, and I've been doing that ever since. I have headphones, there's two needles, there's a mixer in the middle. And if you look at this right here, this is what I call the uniform of hip hop. Now, shout out to my people in Philly, because if anybody's in Philly watching right now, we know that the way they set up their turntables is that they will have two turntables on one side and the mixer on the other side. But by and large, this is what our setup is and this is what it looks like. Miles, what are you working on?
Yes, sir. Same thing, really. But the vinyl record with the slip mat and the plastic is whether I take one of these records over here and put it on, or if I take this record, what it is a time code. This record has a tone on it that just goes doop, and the little piece on the top is what translates the signal by the rotation. So this little receiver is a wireless receiver that tracks the rotation or revolutions per minute, and it tracks exactly. So if you notice, I'm not even looking at any computers. When I'm mixing, I'm looking down at the record just like I would as if I was vinyl. So it's a great invention, you know, that can allow us to take our whole music collection but enable that same vinyl feel and same thing, two turntables, right? I got my mic, I got my mixer, I got my headphones. You can see my turntables do have needles on them. And so I can go from a record to a Serato back and forth. Nobody knows the difference. It's about the feel.
That's right, man. Right.
Hi,
on
Miles and Miles and Jahi. I'm going to ask a question from the audience real quick. I'm from Matthew. She says, when you select the music for your sets, do you pre-plan this for the groove you want and you know what song comes next? Or do you memorize all the music you have and just know what songs match up and when to cut the songs in to build the moods and the groove?
Oh, that's a great question. I will say that this was probably the most curated thing I've ever done, because I normally, I collect vinyl records, and I really love the spontaneity of being able to play records and watch the mood and environment of the people and energy, and then from that, select things right in the moment. There are certain things that you kind of know, certain grooves, but for me, and the way in which I DJ is, I love the idea of the spontaneity, and it helps me to build the creativity. So what I do is if I'm doing a vinyl set, I'll probably pull 100 records. I may only play 50, but I have another 50, you know, so if I have something at my disposal, because different than Serato, because I don't have a computer with everything plugged in, once I've played all the vinyl, that's it. So for me, it's a creative improvisation process.
So like I said earlier, I started on vinyl, and what I would do is I would take all the records that I could possibly carry, and I would put them in an order that I knew. But what I found was that I was spending half of the time bending over or turning around, or, you know, you see my man Jahi has a couple of records right next to his turntables. But when you go and play a 4-hour party, right, you got to think about every record you want to play. But then inevitably somebody would ask for something that you didn't have. So in the new day of Serato, to answer your question specifically, what I do is I create folders by genre and by time period. So I have all of my music, you know, funk, soul, R&B, salsa, reggae, Brazilian, whatever I'm going to play. I know what the framework is. And then I show up and I improvise. That's what it's all about. Just like live instrumentation. Any musician will tell you that the most fun they've ever had and the best recordings they've ever made were unplanned, right? So something like this, as Jahi mentioned, is very curated. We want to be careful about what we're playing. But for the most part, it's about building a framework and then improvising within that.
So we have been able to break that down, but I want to give a context around the history as well of hip hop and hip hop culture, because what we're doing right here, there's a history that's connected to it. And if you go through the forced migration, the transatlantic slave trade, where enslaved Africans went from Africa through Central South America, through the Caribbean, and through the United States, one of the things that we brought with us is our music. Music is a part of the DNA of African people. And when music started to evolve in Jamaica in the 70s, what we saw was the birth of what they call sound clash, sound systems, and toasting. What you see there is a DJ putting a needle to a record. Oh, and in Jamaican terms, the person that is holding the needle, putting it on the vinyl that you see, is called a selector. And the person that you see with the microphone in Jamaican terms is called the DJ. So when someone raps on the microphone in Jamaica, that's called DJing. The original name was toasting. And as we go to the next slide, what you will see is that the godfather of toasting, of dancehall, is a brother by the name of U-Roy, rest in peace. He's known for pioneering the conversational vocal style of toasting, chanting rhythmically over production to boast and hype up a crowd, eventually earning him the name The Originator. Toasting would become a foundation element of dancehall and early hip hop. He would go on to release hits like Wake the Town, Where You to Ball, and starting his own sound systems, Stir Gov, and his mentor younger folks like Shaba Ranks and Tenor Saw. I lived in Jamaica from 1989 to 1991, and I had an opportunity to be in Montego Bay, in Negril, Mount Salem, Trelawney. And what would happen is during the day, people would show up with speakers, and the speakers would stack. And over a period of time, this whole wall behind me would be full of speakers. And then after the speakers were set up, then people would come with their turntables. I saw cassettes, all type of things, and then they would play music all night. And if two people had two different sound systems set up, they would battle each other, and that would be called the sound clash. So a little history about Jamaica, and it's very important as we move on to the next slide, because this is Kool Herc, and we're gonna introduce who he is. But before we do that, we wanna share this video because it's gonna give you some context on the ancient continuum of hip hop culture.
It's a blessing, it's a blessing.
Respect, respect. Still, I wanna understand that. Reggae and hip hop is big time family. You know that? Yeah, man. Yeah, man, definitely. So, you know, it come from the same. Can you see, just like when we DJ and we have the singer coming in and sing and come out, the same way the rappers them do it now. Have the singers coming in and sing and the rapper coming in and same part. So you see, it's family, very close. I mean, so it's big respect.
Important video, because what you're seeing is the godfather of dancehall, who is actually toasting and chanting on the mic and sound systems. And this person that we see here by the name of Kool Herc was a kid at that time, and he lived in Jamaica. So he had those same experiences, but Kool Herc brought those experiences with him to the South Bronx, and he is the father of hip hop culture. And the connection between Jamaica and the South Bronx, even if you look at this photo right here, in the back of his car, he has two booming speakers. He learned that from his experience in Jamaica. As we go to the next slide. So here, what we want to show is the merry-go-round.
Started out. Lean back, dance around, clap your hand, stomp your feet. That part right there with the break, boom, I had to come with bongo rock. Bongo rock was still no vocals in it, and I would go into Baby Yui. You know, the Mexican. And I'm like, whoa.
Science. Peep the science. I want to show some scientific things that are happening. Number one, if you notice on the video, DJ Kool Herc is not using turntables because he is actually using his ear to gauge where the sound is, where the break is, to be able to keep those records moving from one to another. Also, he was using a mixer, and the mixer, he was using the crossfader from one side to another. The other thing is that he was understanding the science of how to keep a groove happening so the people could dance. So he was mimicking those dances. And again, he brought that from Jamaica to the South Bronx. And if you also notice, he's not playing any hip hop records because there were no hip hop records at this time. Now, why do we call him the father of hip hop culture? And if there's a father, there has to be a mother. The mother we consider is Cindy Campbell, his sister, because his sister wanted to have a back to school jam in the rec room at 1520 Segwit Avenue. If you notice, it was 9 p.m. to 4 a.m., 25 cents for the ladies and 50 cents for the fellas. And she asked her brother to DJ. And what we now acknowledge is that August 11th, 1973 is hip hop's birthday, that this was the birth of our culture. And from here, it went from rec rooms to parks. And then
hey, Jahi.
It went to parks all around the world. Yo, what's up, Miles?
Why was it more for the fellas?
Well, you know, you see, I'm not going to get it. I'm just going to say, you know, we still see that sometimes, ladies' night, you know, but
some things don't change, right?
Well, you know what? Here's what I would say. It was Cindy's party, so her friends should be able to do that, but it's all good. We are glad to be able to have this. And now what we want to do is we want to talk about another founding father. Because now that you understand that Kool Herc and Cindy Campbell, the person that we want to center on is Grandmaster Flash. And that hopefully he's watching. I just want to send him a maximum salute, because Grandmaster Flash is our inventor. I said at the Oakland Museum of California that Thomas Edison created the phonograph, but hip hop turned it into an instrument. And Grandmaster Flash is the first person to do that. So when you saw us talking about slip mats and things up under it, that is an invention of Grandmaster Flash. On this record, you may be able to see there's a line on here. These are cue points. Cue points let you know where the break is, so you're able to keep that break going. And Grandmaster Flash, if you saw the documentary film The Get Down, you can see that. But then also he did innovations to the mixer, because he took a toggle switch where if you switch it this way, it would go on. And if you switch it this way, it would go off. He hooked that up on the back of his mixer, so he was able to hear one side of the record while the other one is going. So he can cue this record, so he was able to go back and forth and extend what we call the break. And in the next slide, he's gonna demonstrate what that looks like.
But before we jump to that, there was a question in the chat that I think you answered pretty well, which is the person wants to know, how do you know where the break is on a vinyl record? And what we would do is we would listen. That's the answer. And we would watch the rotation. And when it got to 12 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 9 o'clock, we would remember that. And we know that's where that break hit, and go back and forth with what he called a toggle switch, or what's now known as a crossfader. So when I do it, I literally look at where the position is of the white mark. And that's how I know where my breaks are going to hit.
That's right. So I would encourage, that was a great question, because what you're asking is, what is the science behind what we do? And one of the things that is very important as a DJ is the ability to be able to listen to records. Sometimes the sweet part, the break, might be at the very end of a record, you know, so you have to be able to listen through all of that. But I want to shout out Grandmaster Flash, because he is our inventor. And here is an example from him from Wild Style doing what he created and coined, what is called the quick mix theory.
The official adventures of
the Grandmaster
Nice. The quick mix theory, knowing where your cue points are, going back and forth, keeping the beat on time, keeping the people's feet moving. That's what we do for a living. So right here, I'd like to just go into a quick demonstration, because we are called scratching the surface, right? So I've trained a lot of young DJs. They all want to know two things, how to mix and how to scratch. We've been talking about how to mix. You just have to count 1, 2, 3, 4. Make sure you stay on time, know your music, and make sure your rhythm is good. But how do you actually scratch? Well, what I tell people is there are 5 basic scratches that you would want to learn. And let me just clarify, I don't consider myself to be a turntablist. I'm not winning any scratch competitions, right? I'm a party rocking DJ. But what I found is that these 5 basic scratches will allow you to express that within the context of music. So you might hear this a lot. A lot of DJs like to use this one sound, and it goes like this. The reason we like that sound is because it's real crisp and you can break it down. So when most people say, you DJ, you go wiki, 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 that's what we call a baby scratch, and it goes like this. Been doing that since 13 years old. The second one, though, that most people don't know is a drag. When you let the record play and then drag it back. So I can baby scratch, I can drag, and then there's another one that's a little harder called a chirp. It kind of sounds like the chirping of a bird. It goes like this. So that was my chirp. Got to work on my chirp a little bit. And then the other one is the transform. And what we do is we take that sound, ah, which goes one, two, three, four, and we break it up into fractions. Eight, quarter, half, three quarters, whole, like this. So if you put all those together to a beat, it sounds like this. The one I forgot is the scribble. So I could break that up any kind of way I want. Shout out to Grand Wizard Theodore and shout out to DJ Jazzy Jeff, my inspirations when it comes to scratching. Scratching is really about just creating a flow within the music.
Before Jahi comes back, we have a quick question from Rachel, who is loving this session. That's awesome. But what are Jahi's and Miles' thoughts on the increased popularity of DJs during the pandemic? Miles, I know you've been busy with the Groove Lounge, but anything from Jahi, Miles?
You know, I'm really glad you said that because I want to shout out to all the DJs around the world. We didn't have enough time to share all the different names, but I think that out of the pandemic, again, a part of hip hop culture that we make a way out of no way. We turn crisis into triumph, and the DJ community around the world, shout out to D-Nice, shout out to D-Nice, shout out to Versus, was able to help us get through the pandemic. So it really shows the medicinal properties that a DJ can provide. And I will have to say this personally that most people don't know, but for the last 15 months, every week, I have been DJing for my mother on Zoom. She is in her 70s, she has Alzheimer's and dementia, and she needs 24-hour care. And she may not remember certain things, but she would watch my hands on the turntable. I would show certain records, and she would sit up in her wheelchair. So for me, I've realized that during this pandemic, it has helped me to be able to not only build my craft, but I also felt like it was a Sankofa that I gave back to my mother. What she gave to me was the power of music.
Nice. And I would say, just to piggyback on that, is that, you know, DJing is a live in-person art form. And so the pandemic forced us in. It took the DJs that were at the top and turned them back into bedroom DJs. And so what it did was it made you ask the question with no hype, no lights, no people. Are you doing this because you truly love it? And I think that's the separation, right? So I came to the lab and I'm focused on audiovisual. I never mentioned DJing to anybody at all. But what I decided in the pandemic was that let me use this art form to reach out to people. And it meant a lot to me that people used it as a way to stay connected with each other. Like he said, it was medicine. But it wasn't just for you. It was for me as well, because I had no gigs and I was depressed. I had to DJ for somebody, right? And so the Groove Lounge was like a blessing to all of us. And I appreciate all you that support it. But ultimately, it's really about doing it because you love it, doing it from the heart and soul. And I think the pandemic just really intensified that for DJs.
So as you can see, as DJs, not only are we handling music, but in reality, we are scientists. That's why this is a hip hop STEM story. Hopefully you can see the science, the technology, the engineering and mathematics that takes place, because even in what we were doing earlier, we count revolutions, beat per minute, but you know what? How does the sound come out of the record? We're missing something here, Miles. So what I think we need to do is we need to bring back in our sound expert. Hey, Carl, Dr. Haber, tell us what's happening.
Okay, well, I think we talked about how sound gets on the record, and you guys showed us an infinite range of possibilities about how you can manipulate and create art with that sound that's on the record way more than just putting it down and playing it back, which is what I think the inventors had in mind. They were the early inventors, but you and the hip hop community has shown just a tremendously incredible creative potential of this invention of the phonograph record. But finally, when you're moving the record by yourself or it's spinning by itself, at the end of the day, there's a little needle called the stylus that is riding in that groove. And the question that you're asking is, what happens then? So if you went down to the very tip of the tone arm that's holding that stylus, it's embedded in a little box, which is called a cartridge. And inside the cartridge, there's a magnet that's connected to the needle. And as the needle moves, the magnet moves. And the magnet is near a coil of wire. And when you have a magnet and a coil of wire and they're moving relative to each other, an electrical signal is created. And that signal is very, very small, but it goes into an amplifier, which manipulates electricity to increase the electrical signal, which then goes back into another coil that pushes another magnet. This is inside the base of a speaker, and that moving magnet is now connected to a large paper cone. And as that magnet moves, the paper cone moves, and it pushes the air, creates a pressure wave, which is sound, that exactly follows the pattern that the needle is moving. And it sets up this pressure wave, which travels through the atmosphere and then finally back into our ears. Hopefully it's loud and clear.
So thanks for that explanation, Carl. I think we have the full story, even though it's a short story for today. We've gone from understanding about what sound is to how is it recorded, how can it be restored, and how can it be used in order to move a body with our DJs, Jahi and Miles. And so I'd like to invite everybody to come back on screen now. We have been putting together this program for a while, and so I'd like to thank all of you for us collaborating together, kind of remixing live science and getting to celebrate the innovation in hip hop and see what Berkeley Lab is doing also in innovation and research. And so this is the first of hopefully a series of events where we think about culture, community, and art together, thinking about how we're changing the world. Our charge here at Berkeley Lab is the science solutions for the world. And so I hope you all enjoyed what we did today. I hope you'll ask many, many more questions. This is scratching the surface, but we will also be back hopefully in the fall to think about other ways in which we can think about STEM and art. Please enjoy the rest of the Pride events that are coming out this month, as well as the recognition of Juneteenth today as a federal holiday. We hope you also get to take part in events that are happening around that. And so with that, I'm going to leave it off to Jahi and Miles to take us out and help us start the weekend. So thanks everybody for joining, and we hope you have a wonderful day. We'll be right back.
original raw. The original raw. The original raw.
Party people.